Welcome to Eat Sleep Suplex Retweet. I am your host, Billy Strachan, a name you're not familiar with on ESSR, but I do host the SWN podcast. There you go, get my own plug in right away, even though I said I wouldn't. You gotta do the housekeeping first, though, before I go any further. I've learned. So you can visit Eat Sleep Suplex Retweet on Facebook at Suplex Retweet, Twitter at Suplex Retweet. Available on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, and Android podcast platforms. You can visit the website eatsleepsuplexretweet.com. Right, that's that bit done in the way. I am joined this interview, my first debut, this taking my interview cherry on ESSR, is Discovery Wrestling co-owner Alan Smith. Welcome to the show.
Hello, thanks for having me. You did that so professionally at the very top of the hour, getting all your plugs in. I think you'd be a fine announcer one day, Billy.
Well, one day. I've had my experience. I think that's enough.
Yeah, we don't need to talk about them days.
No.
But yeah.
But we've got you on because disco is back. That's what I'm hearing on the grapevine.
Yes.
Discovery Wrestling is returning. So October 17th, Edinburgh Corn Exchange. Are you excited?
Yeah. Oh, I'm absolutely buzzing. I'm actually, there's a bit of me that's quite nervous about it all just because it's been that long. And, you know, going back into the kind of show day stresses of making sure everything runs okay and making sure everybody gets exactly what they, you know, they paid for and making sure that people have a great time. So there's the nerves are there again about, like, making sure this goes off as it's supposed to go off, and you know, all the travel's okay and everybody who's meant to be there actually gets there, and you know, so there's all these little things that kind of add to your kind of show day stresses that I'm starting to remember I'll have those again. But like, overall, I'm so excited because it has been 18 months. By the time the show rolls around, it will have been 18 months since our last event. There's a lot of people I haven't seen in that period of time, and so I'm just so, I guess, buzzing is the word to see those guys again and actually see some disco wrestling and see the fans back, and the first time I hear them chanting disco wrestling, I'm just gonna, I'll try and hold in the emotion, but it'll probably show a little bit. Now that we're getting so close to it, it's just, yeah, I can't wait for it to roll about.
Like you're saying, February 2020, All About the Raffle was the last show at the Jam House, which of course is no longer as well. So a lot has changed in that 18 months.
Yeah, particularly venues. You're right, the Jam House. They're looking for someone else to go in and run the place now. So we're just waiting to see who the new folk are going to be, and hopefully they'll like wrestling and want wrestling in, because that's something I found in Edinburgh is a lot of venues, you know, as soon as you're making an inquiry about using their venue, and they're like, oh yeah, let me have a look at dates. Oh, what is it you do? And they go, well, it's a professional wrestling event. Oh no, we're not suitable, bye. And the phone just kind of goes down with a lot of these venues. I don't know if it's just, you know, they don't really understand what we do, or just have this kind of a different kind of idea of what it is that we do. But you know, we've had great venues in Edinburgh, whether it be the Jam House, which has just been, was so well suited to what we do, the Corn Exchange, which has now been taken over by O2, so it's now an O2 Academy, Edinburgh as it's called now. And there's a couple of other venues that we're in talks with about possibly doing something next year. So they're not open at the moment, but they're hoping to kind of open for next year. So that's been the big challenge about planning the comeback for us, has been getting venues in Edinburgh and having, you know, being able to get this full schedule for next year confirmed. So we're still in the process of doing that. So we're fortunate that we still have a venue like the Corn Exchange. It'll always be known as the Corn Exchange to me, but the O2 Edinburgh, that, you know, they really enjoy what we do. They love having us there. So anytime we say we want to put on a show there, they're more than welcome in. So long may it continue, and hopefully we get into another couple of new venues next year and have a packed schedule.
Corn Exchange especially seems to be it's like your big show. That's where it always be. That's where the Elite were, of course. When you got the Elite in, and that was that the one with Bullet Club as well, or was that?
We've been in the Corn Exchange a few times now. The Corn Exchange has two rooms, so They've got what's called the Baron, which is a kind of cabaret type room. It's where we're going to be in October. We're going to start off there with the hopes of going bigger in the coming months. So we're starting off there, and that's, you know, in that venue, in that room, we've had the likes of Joe Coffey versus Tommaso Ciampa happened there. Michael Chase versus Juventud Guerrera happened in there. We've had a lot of fantastic matches and a bit of history. Jay Lethal defended the Ring of Honor Heavyweight Championship in the Baron Suite of the Con Exchange, and that was the first time that the Ring of Honor Heavyweight Championship had been defended in Scotland. So that's, you know, the room has a lot of history with us and a lot of sentiment as well. So that's kind of one of the reasons we're going back in there to kickstart as we come back, because there's a lot of good memories in there. It's a great atmosphere, and you know, it'll be packed. And the hope is then moving to that big main exchange, which is a hell of a size of venue to fill. Hence, when we've filled it, it's been events like having, you know, the Bucks and Omega there, or when we had the Bullet Club there, or, you know, Cody Rhodes defending the Ring of Honor Championship the second time it was defended in Scotland. So it there's a lot of history with us in the Con Exchange, and that's that big room, the big exchange. That's the kind of when we know we've got something massive coming up, and that's where we tend to go.
Right, so if there's ever an announcement saying it's going to be in the big room, the Corn Exchange, you know, everyone should be on edge, just going, oh.
Oh, 100%, yeah. Yeah, 100%. They should just go, right, I'm just going to buy a ticket anyway, even if they don't announce anything. Which, to be fair, I mean, the comeback show sold out within a week. Granted, it's the Baron that we're in, but that's still, you know, a good few hundred people, and it selling out within a week without announcing a single match, which blew my mind. I knew obviously people were desperate to get back to wrestling and seeing live wrestling again. We all are. You have your kind of front couple of rows, which are always your hardcore kind of dedicated following that, you know, whenever you put those tickets on sale, you know who's buying them. Like, I know them, you know, I see them every time, I've chatted them at every event. So I thought on day one, when we put them on sale, I thought, right, okay, front row might sell out today. We'll see how it goes. You know, half an hour later, right, that's front row gone. They're sold. I was just, okay, let's see how the rest goes. And by the end of the day, you know, second row had gone as well. And it just kept on coming during that week. You know, all the general tickets were getting snapped up, and come the Sunday, you know, put tickets on sale on the Monday, and the Sunday night, that was it. They were all gone. And I never expected them to sell that quickly before announcing a single match. You know, we've not announced a single match for the event, and we've sold out the show. We've got people asking to be put on a waiting list in case any tickets become available. It's just, you know, it was pretty overwhelming when we got to that point and seen how quickly they went. And I guess it's just a good sign kind of going forward and coming back that there are so many people that are still wanting to come and watch wrestling. They're desperate to come back and see a live event. They want to come back and see what we do. So, yeah, it's pretty massive for us, actually. And it just adds to the excitement levels for me, and I guess those nerves again for the comeback show, to make sure that everybody who's coming to see us in October has a great time, and then they'll want to come back time and time again.
I mean, one of the questions when I put to the team, if they want to know anything in particular, one was, what was the biggest challenges for Discovery following the pandemic? But you've kind of touched on that a little bit, thinking, are people going to want to see it? But was there any other big challenges that you found?
Yeah, well, I guess it's just that. It's just, you know, hoping that people just don't disappear, because we had quite a lot of time of inaction when we didn't have things to promote. We didn't have things to kind of put out there. A lot of the stuff we filmed in the past, or all content, it's all out there, whether it be on the fight shows or whether it be on YouTube. Or so it's just those kind of periods of inaction when we're kind of sitting quiet, kind of going, right, we're just going to have to sit and wait for news and plan for the comeback. And we did have a good few online raffles. You know, our fans love raffles. They go daft for a raffle. So we tried to fill our time a little bit by doing some online raffles, which were fun. But the challenge for me was just that inaction and just not knowing when we might get back, not knowing what some of the conditions might be in terms of coming back, even, you know, planning logistically for if, you know, if we're looking at wrestlers from out with Scotland, what are the travel conditions going to be? So it made it really kind of difficult to plan a lot of those things. The venues, which I talked about, you know, obviously the Jam House, it closed during the pandemic, and are just in the process of getting new management in. So those kinds of things, it's been difficult to try and get venues confirmed, because the couple of venues we're talking to, they're still closed despite things opening up again. They're still not taking bookings for events at the moment. They're just kind of sitting and waiting until they can get fully staffed and whatever else. So those were the big challenges, and hopefully we're starting to overcome them now.
I mean, you were burned quite a few times during this pandemic, of course, because everything started in March 2020, and of course you had the Disco Derby, which had to be cancelled. And then when things looked like they were clearing up, you announced Back to the Baron for July 19th, 2020, which had to be cancelled.
Yeah. So,
and then, of course, the next discovery, March 14th.
March, yeah. So at the point that March got cancelled, I just learned the lesson. It took me two or three attempts to learn my lesson of not announcing anything. But, you know, we just wanted to give something for people to look forward to, you know, because this has been a terrible year and a half for people for all sorts of reasons. And we know how much people look forward to coming to a disco show. We see the comments on Twitter or on Facebook after a show, or when we're announcing a show, just the lift it gives to people, because we know a lot of the people who come along have a tough time, and this is an escape for them. And especially given the last year and a half, you know, you just wanted to give people something to kind of look forward to, kind of, you know, right, okay, if I get through these next couple of months, I'm going to get back to go and see a disco show. So that was part of why I wanted to give people just something. It's just like, right, look, this is something we can all look forward to. Let's just stick with it. Let's get through this, and then we'll get back to wrestling as soon as it's safe. But after the March one, I thought, you know what, I'm just going to hold off until everything's properly confirmed that we can actually do this again.
Yeah, you'd be burning through all the show names and posters by that point, and or you've got them like going, no, we'll use them again. Don't you worry about it, because that Back to the Future one, particular Back to the Baron, I was like, that's all up my wheelhouse. I loved it. I loved that poster particularly.
Well, I have a gimmick idea for that entire show, which I'll probably still do. So, this is probably be a massive spoiler for when we actually do announce Back to the Baron and use the Back to the Future stuff again. But the whole one of the ideas behind what we're going to do and just have a bit of fun with the show is where we're going to transport some of the wrestlers back to their original gimmicks.
Oh, amazing.
So, you know, for example, Aspen Faith, he would have to go back to being the Hippie Horror. Session Moth Martina would have to go back to being Kaza G. You know, like, so, like, all the wrestlers, you know, had, like, original gimmicks, which they don't have just now, and they probably still have all original gear. So my idea was to do a kind of Back to the Future type thing where, like, everybody gets put back in time to the very start of the wrestling career, and it's their original gimmicks and it's the original looks and things they come out with. So, you know, I've still got that there as a gimmick. I'm putting out now so people know I've got this gimmick, which I'll drop at some point. And just to have a bit of fun with it, because I think that's what kind of people expect from us is you know, the shows are fun. You know, there are matches which are just purely great wrestling matches, but sprinkled in with a lot of fun throughout the event. Things like, you know, All About the Raffle, which was an event where matches were decided by wrestlers picking numbers out of a hat, you know, and then us kind of going, right, it's number 44 versus number 63, who have we got, type of thing. So yeah, I think Back to the Bad and the Back to the Future gimmick, I think that's got to happen. It's one I'm desperate to make happen.
Well, now you've mentioned it, that's all I want to see. And I'm just thinking of all these wrestlers that had original gimmicks that are so far and away what they were, what they are now. It's just, yeah, I love DCT coming out in his old journalist gear. Back to David Campbell Thompson. Oh, there's so much fun that could be had there. And that's going to be what I'm going to be thinking of for the next probably couple weeks. Just seeing all these old pictures, especially like Aspen in his hippie horror gear going, oh, man.
Yeah, well, I remember that well because when I was still a wrestler, I wrestled Aspen when he was the hippie horror. So I remember it well. But yeah, I think wrestlers would get a kick out of it as well, just to get the chance to kind of go back in time a bit. There might be a bit of a kind of cringe factor in there when people actually look back on how they launched their wrestling careers, but I think it'll be a lot of fun. So that's possibly something we could be doing in the new year. I'll just leave it at that.
Can't wait. Absolutely can't wait. So we'll go and buy the poster that's for Disco Is Back. We've got Emerson Jane coming to the show. I've got Andy Wilde, Theodorus, Gene Money, Martina, of course, women's champion, and Joe Hendry, the Discovery Wrestling Y Division champion. But that's not the only championships that are going to be there. You've got tag team titles now.
Yeah, this is something that fans have been asking us for since day one. And it's something that, you know, like we always tried to do things just a little bit different at Disco. And, you know, originally we were going to have what was going to be yearly tag team champions. So, we did a tournament. It was and it ended with a match called Uncivil War, which is a four-way tag team chaos, essentially, four-way tag team match, where it was a tournament ran through the year, the final four teams, and the winner of that match would be known as, the tag team champions of 2017. So they'd be known as, and then we did the tournament again next year and the year after, and there'd always be a tag team champions for that year. And so we tried to do something just slightly different. And while the matches were great and the final match was as chaotic as what we were hoping it would be, people were like, oh man, it would just be great if you had tag team titles. It would be great if you had titles. And it was just like, okay. So we thought, right, okay, we need to have tag team titles. That's what people want. We always aim to give people what they want. But it just took a bit of time because if anybody's ever seen the Disco titles, they are pretty special. You know, we take a lot of time over them. We make sure they're real wrestling titles. Everything about them, you know, are the real wrestling titles that could stand up in any company in the world. You know, you can look at the title and think, God, that's a beautiful wrestling title. I guess I'm a bit of a kind of title mark as well. So I'm just, you know, yeah, I kind of put trust in title designers and belt makers to create something pretty special. So, you know, if you've seen the Y Division Championship, which was made by Paul Martin, championship belts, and then the Women's Championship, which was designed by Gav at Main Event Belts, the tag team titles really needed to stand up to those two titles for me. And that's not something that just happens overnight. You know, it's a process, a design process. Just to get to that kind of level of what we were after. So that happened during lockdown. The titles were finally ready to be unveiled, but obviously we had no shows to do them on, to have them presented. So we waited and we waited and we waited and had these titles, brand new, real leather smell, just sitting in my office, and we were able to have finally unveiled them earlier this year. So October will be the start of the search for tag team champions. It's going to be, we'll be announcing a tag team tournament, which will run over a few shows. And we're going to see who's worthy of the tag team titles. And it's, we're basically any tag team anywhere, if they wanted to come and challenge, you know, can get in touch with us. You know, it's not necessarily just a tag team division for men. It's men, women, mixed teams, whatever. You know, if you're a team and you think you can win these tag team titles, then come and have a go.
I mean, the guys that you've, well, the tag teams that you've had over the years in Discovery, I mean, likes of course, a regular team being Kings of the North. You've also had the Young Bucks a couple of times, just putting that out there. So is there any particular tag teams that have your eye on, possibly, that could be contenders to these titles?
My dream team, and it's the team I've always wanted to have over in Disco, but I don't know if it would ever happen, would be the Motor City Machine Guns. I think that would be the ultimate for me, would be to have those guys over. Obviously, we've had Chris Sabin over a few times, and he was our first Y Division champion. So it kind of fits for me if somehow we could arrange for him to bring Alex Shelley with him next time. So, but again, I think that's quite far off from ever happening. But there's a lot of great teams within the UK and Ireland who, you know, have been in contact looking for, they've seen these championship titles, they've seen how beautiful they are, and they want a piece. So we're not going to be short of great teams competing for this.
I mean, your titles, and they're all beautiful titles. I love a beautiful wrestling belt. Just nothing better. But when you think about the Y Division Championship, of course, Chris Sabin being the first champion, the women's title was presented by Lisa Marie Veron. So they've got quite a... The tag titles are quite a big shoe to fill, I suppose, when it comes to the being presented and how big this tournament's going to be. Everything just seems to be fall into place, hopefully. That's the hope, anyway. Yeah. We're not going to get any more cancellations. Yeah.
Fingers crossed. I mean, the way things are looking just now, you're just praying things get better again before we get to kind of showtime and, you know, people feel safe. That's the main thing, is that people feel safe when they're coming along, and, you know, we'll do whatever's kind of asked of us to make sure that happens.
Yeah, there's a lot of moving parts, of course. Just very recently announcing things like nightclubs needing COVID passports and things like that. So it's ever changing when it comes to October 17th for those that are unaware, that's my brother's birthday. There you go. There's some fun facts for you. 2 p.m. Were you very conscious of keeping it at afternoon shows, because that seems to be quite a good success? I would love to go to afternoon shows.
I do love an afternoon show because I feel that it's great for families. It's great for a lot of people kind of travel to us, use public transport, trains, buses. So having an afternoon show means there's going to be plenty of trains and buses after we're done. We have had evening shows before when we've done, you know, we've had the Elite over or whatever, because we've had to do it during the week. You know, we weren't able to do the events at the weekend, so we did it during the week. That just adds to the pressure levels, because, you know, right, we need to finish at like 10 o'clock, because if we run over to like 10:30 or 10:45, there are going to be people who are leaving early to go and grab a train and a bus, and they're going to miss what they've paid to see. So, you know, the afternoon shows just helps us kind of relax just a little bit more. It's just less stressful. And I think it's just better for families as well to have like an afternoon out as well, rather than have to worry about the evenings. A lot of our events take place on a Sunday as well, so obviously it's a school night. Afternoons, we're going to keep it that way going forward. We're going to keep Saturdays, Sundays, afternoons will be our thing.
So you mentioned the Elite again. I've mentioned them several times, and I know we've spoken about it at length in my own podcast. I'll plug it again, SWM podcast. But people will still be very interested seeing the Bucks and, of course, Omega doing pretty well in AEW. They're doing not bad. They would want to know how, what was it like getting the Elite in, and how easy was it? If I mind right, it was just a case of right place, right time. But how was it getting the Elite over?
Yeah, it was exactly that. It was right place, right time. We had the Young Bucks on our third ever event. And this is going back, obviously, way, way back before AEW days, and, you know, how massive all that is. You know, this is, we had an event in a community centre in Edinburgh. And we work with some other promoters in the UK at times. You know, they'll say, hey, look, I've got so-and-so's coming to the UK. We're looking to fill out dates for them, so they've got a bit of a run in the UK. Would you be interested in having them on a date? You know, so we had an event that just happened to fall in line with when the Young Bucks were in the UK. So that they did an event for us in a community centre in Edinburgh, you know, which had about 300 people there, and now they're doing what they're doing. But we just kind of built a relationship from that point, because they came over, you know, they loved Edinburgh, they loved our setup, they loved the people. And so anytime they were thinking about coming to the UK, it was just dropping us a line saying, hey, look, I want to come to the UK. Do you have anything available? And so, yeah, no bother. So the second time they came back was with Omega. And it was just this weird conversation with you know, with us, you know, they got in touch and said, hey, look, we want to come back to the UK. We're putting together a tour. We're going to do this promotion in England. We're going to do this promotion in Ireland. Can we do a show with you guys? We're like, yeah, absolutely. Yeah, we'll set something up. We'll make it work. You know, we'll get a venue. We'll get a date. And they said, there's only one thing, though. And we're like, yeah, sure. What is it? Kenny's coming with us. And I was just like, we're like, sure. Yeah, no bother. Yeah, that's fine. Yeah, we can make it. I'm sure we can make that work. Absolutely fine. So, you know, it's just kind of been built on relationships. And when people come over and they have a good time and everything goes smoothly and, you know, they just grew to love Edinburgh when they were here. Hence why, you know, after they were here the second time, Ring of Honor were in Edinburgh not too long after, because, you know, the Young Bucks had gone back to Ring of Honor and said, look, when you're doing UK, because we said to them that whenever Ring of Honor were coming to the UK, it was like UK tour, but there was never a date outside of England. It was just like a UK tour. So we kind of said, you know, you should have a word and tell them if they're doing a UK tour, to Scotland. There's a cracking venue there that you've just experienced. You know, I'm sure we could help and help if you needed any help. And then a few months later, Ring of Honor were in the Corn Exchange. So so they've obviously grown a bit of an attachment when they come to the UK. That's I guess one of the first places they think about coming to.
Well, that must be, I mean, you've been around wrestling for quite a while, a number of years now. I was going to say a while, but that makes you sound older than you are. A number of years, we'll go with that.
12.
Just a fine round dozen. Is it still kind of just a bit mind-blowing when you do get these messages from Young Bucks and these talents from the US and all around the world going, oh, I want to come to Discovery Wrestling?
Well, I guess originally when, you know, when we were putting out the first event, because you just don't know how it's going to go, and the first event, and we're going to keep dropping names here, but you know, the first event, when we're trying to make the first event as big as it possibly could be, to try and get some attention, to show people, hey, look, come and see what we're going to be doing. And you're relying on a bit of kind of blind faith from those guys, because they can't go online and see your previous shows. They can't go online and see if you're legit. They can't go online and see how people have been treated before, like with being at your events. So, you know, when we're able to get, it was Mike Mondo, we've got Crime Time and Chris Sabin. That at that point, it was just like, holy cow, you know, these people are going to come in and do an event for us. But the event went smooth. And at that point, you know, Chris Sabin coming back another couple of times, the Young Bucks coming in, it just becomes part of, it's the business, it's part of your business. It's just like, right, okay, we're establishing ourselves as a good company to work for. And people want to work for us, the reputation spreads. So at that stage, you don't get that kind of surprise moment when you get an email drop into your inbox to say, hey, look, so-and-so told me to reach out to you if I was ever coming to the UK. I'm going to be about in these dates. Would you have an event? So at this stage, I think now that we've kind of built a bit of a reputation as being a good place to work, that thing happens more often.
So last year and on this year, of course, WWE released quite a number of talent, as a lot of companies have. A lot have been picked up, but there's a couple former Discovery names in there, the likes of Demo, of course. But when that happens, not obviously, you're not going to immediately go, I'm booking you now, but is there any names that have popped up in that thinking, well, I think we could do something with them in Discovery? Is there anyone, you don't have to give me total spoilers, but is there anyone that comes to mind?
Yeah, well, you know, there are people who would obviously love to have back at Disco. The difficulty for us at the moment is just the uncertainties around the kind of current situation. I think it'll be a while before we book people to travel into the country as a one-off, because it still feels risky to me, you know, if you're going, right, okay, I'm going to book someone that's just been released, they're going to appear on our show in 2 months' time, and then we get closer to the date, and then all of a sudden the international travel shuts down again, or something happens with COVID that the quarantine rules change again, or something that means it's not going to happen after you promoting a, an event just off that kind of one thing. So for me, I'm avoiding kind of going down that route right now until I feel totally confident, 100% confident that would happen. So that's just that's I guess my way of trying to manage expectations for anybody who's thinking, oh, then the anniversary show, we're going to get, you know, Big Damo's going to be back, or you know, anyone else who's kind of kicking about just now, just kind of managing expectations just a little bit. But yeah, you know, I would love to have Damo back. You know, I'm sure he's got a lot of unfinished business in Disco as well, and the guys who are currently on the roster, I'm sure you would have a great time throwing them about.
So what we're saying is, if you're thinking we're going to get Braun Strowman against anyone anytime soon, maybe just curb that expectation a little bit.
Well, yeah, if you know, if Braun wants to come over, then by all means, he's more than welcome to come over. I'm sure a match between Braun and maybe Gene Money would be a good headliner for us, or Braun versus Andy Wilde, or, you know, it'd be a spectacle.
I mean, you're throwing out the matches here. I'm saying nothing. So, I mean, I think they would all work. Get them in a poster, and I'm sure it'd be sold out even before the match is announced, with the reputation that Discovery is built. It's really great that it has, like you say, it's been 18 months, and Discovery still has that like buzz and that like reputation that people are just trusting you. That, yeah, we're gonna put down our tickets for this. We need to see what Disco provides. Now, we're recording this just before you're announcing matches, but we're going to put it out afterwards, so we're not going to spoil anything for those that for some reason access my cloud and hack it and get listen to it. But there's a couple matches hopefully that are coming out this week. What are they? What's coming on?
Well, I think it's only fitting that we kick off announcements with the title matches. And so we've got two big title matches confirmed for October 17th. The first one is the Women's Championship. So Session with Martina has now been champion for ever so long because of COVID. I think she might be the longest reigning Women's Champion in Disco, with having 18 months of inaction. So that title will be on the line. Session Moth will be defending that line, and she'll be going up against Emerson Jane. Before lockdown hit, Emerson had gotten herself in a position where she was number one contender again. So that's going to be a massive match for us, because you've got now the longest reigning Women's Champion going up against the first ever Women's Champion. So we're either going to see the record reign continue, or we're going to see the first ever two-time Disco Women's Champion. So that's the first big match announcement that we're making for October 17th. And the second one is the Y Division Championship with Joe Hendry. He's now approaching some sort of records. He's not at the record point yet. I'm sure he's approaching Lewis Girvin's 666 days, which was quite the number to run to. And then beyond that, you've got Joe Coffey's record as well. So I think Joe Hendry will be eyeing up these records. But he's going up against the guy who's waited. He's waited 19 months for this title match. And that's Theodorus. Theodorus became the number one contender at the end of, it would have been the end of 2019. Theodorus became the number one contender. And in February last year, he beat BT Gunn to kind of really cement himself as a proper contender for this championship. And if you speak to Theodorus, you know that the last 18, 19 months for him has been about this match. He's been working, he's been building himself, he's been in that ring training. He's obviously been getting himself established elsewhere as well. This is the match that he's desperate to have. You know, when we put out the event poster and he's on the poster as well, like, his message to me, he was just delighted that he was one of the faces on a Disco poster, because that's where he wants to be. He wants to be the main event in Disco. So you've got Joe Hendry and Theodorus, which I think it's just going to be an incredible match. And I think he's going to surprise a lot of people in that match.
We've certainly seen Theo, of course, on the WWE Network, wrestling on there, using his traditional wrestling style, even if he does take a couple shortcuts along the way. But we'll be seeing Joe Hendry, who's just this transformation. He's yet to reveal the final form. So it could be October 17th where we finally see the final form of Joe Hendry, which it seems it's going to be a scary sight. Have you been able to? I'm intrigued.
I'm waiting as well. I don't want the surprise to be spoiled for me. I want to see it on the day. I want to react like everybody else reacts. He's been putting in like a hell of an amount of training in during his lockdown, and anyone who follows him on Instagram will see the weights he's lifting just now. It's just a ridiculous amount of weight. You know, was he not deadlifting something like 500 pounds or something, you know? He could probably at this rate, if you remember Kuma, Big Kuma, I wouldn't be surprised if Joe Hendry, the way he's lifting just now, could lift Kuma off his feet. You know, I've never seen anyone do that ever, but I reckon the way that Joe Henry's going, he could maybe be the guy to pick Kuma up. He's just in phenomenal shape right now.
Yeah, I mean, I was lucky enough to have a chat with him earlier in the year, and he seems so determined, and so because he's had this layoff from Ring of Honor for so long because he can't travel, he seems to be almost intensely, scarily determined to, when he comes back to the ring, that it's going to be a momentous event. So, I mean, Theodorus is fantastic, but it's quite an intimidating sight, like we're saying, to come up against this evolution of Joe Hendry.
Yeah, and you know, I think from a kind of wrestling standpoint, if you're into your pure wrestling, I guess is what people kind of call it these days, you know, that technical wrestling, you know, Theodorus loves this traditional style of matches. You've got Joe Hendry, who is, an amateur wrestler for Scotland in the Commonwealth Games. So there's going to be a great technical battle between Joe Hendry and Theodorus. I'm so intrigued as to how it might go. Really, really intrigued.
And we kind of brushed past a little bit, of course, Emerson Jane, who herself had a transformation, a little bit of an evolution from a previous persona. Of course, Session Moth Martina, who is also with Ring of Honor. So that little Ring of Honor kind of link is still kind of strong in Discovery Wrestling. Is that a company that you like having that kind of relationship with? Is there any thoughts about maybe trying to link up with more Japanese ones? Of course, these are baby steps right now, but in the future, linking up with other companies around the globe.
Yeah, I mean, our door is always open if anybody wants to work with us, and that goes for any promotion, you know. I think the Ring of Honor stuff with having our two champions being in Ring of Honor, I think that's pure coincidence. You know, that wasn't kind of done by design. That was just, it just happened to be there's our champions and now they're in Ring of Honor. It was just, or they were in Ring of Honor and then became champions. It was just, a coincidence, but it's a lovely, lovely, lovely coincidence to have happened. We'll just keep putting ourselves out there as an independent promotion, and if people want to kind of work with us in some way, then absolutely would. So, you know, I'd love to. One of the things I would have loved to have done, and I could maybe still be done one day, was to have the 10 pounds of gold in Disco. I think that would be very cool. You know, I did have those kind of those thoughts, you know, back just before lockdown happened, about building to an anniversary event and how cool it would be if we could, you know, when Nick Aldis is in the UK, to maybe have set something up when he was a champion to do like a 10 pounds of gold in Disco. So that would be something I'd love to strive for, is to have just little bits of history that we can add. You know, obviously we had, you know, the Ring of Honor history with their heavyweight championship being defended in a Disco ring twice. So to have, you know, if one day we can make it happen that, you know, the NWA championship could be defended in the Disco ring, like, I think it's possible. I think it's doable. It's probably quite far off, but you know, you've got to dream and you've got to have that ambition. And if we can make it happen one day, I'd love to have that to happen.
Your forbidden door is not forbidden at all. It's quite, you're quite happy to have it open to to anyone. Yeah. Terrible phrasing, but you know what I mean. So again, we're saying baby steps and everything right now, but is there any thought, any inkling to move outside of Edinburgh? Are you quite comfortable being in Edinburgh to have be your home base?
Yeah, Edinburgh is definitely my home base. You know, everything that I've got just now is based in Edinburgh. You know, it's I think we've established something really special in Edinburgh. It's just for us, it's just finding the venues and hopefully getting a full schedule set up for next year. I mean, I've never really been interested in going elsewhere because everybody's got their own thing going on in their own patch of the country. So, but I'm not going to lie, thoughts have crossed my mind of doing like a summer tour at times, but it's just, yeah, I think it's best for us to kind of stick with what we've got and just focus on just putting on the events that we are doing. But, you know, if there was a town somewhere that was crying out for disco and someone said, bring disco here, everybody wants to see disco here, then who knows? But certainly I've got no firm plans to take the show on the road. It's very much, we're very much Edinburgh's wrestling promotion.
I think that little bit of an outcry for getting disco places, because I know there is many people that are like, well, why can't you take it here and what have you, is because of that hunger for wrestling. But whether you like it or not, I think disco is probably the, if not the, it's definitely in like the top three exciting wrestling companies in Scotland. I would even push it to say top five in the UK. We've mentioned that you are kind of like taking as it comes, and these amazing things have happened with like a Chris Sabin and what have you. But do you find that this added is an added pressure that may be unwanted, that you're like, oh, why everyone thinks that we're one of the best companies in the UK? Why kind of thing is, yeah, is that come to mind at all?
I think sometimes maybe we come off a lot bigger than what we actually are. You know, when you break it down as to what the promotion is and how many people are working behind the scenes, it's not many people, you know. And I think that perhaps we've maybe just grown that reputation of being like putting on a decent show, putting on a good show, and being a good company that people want to work for. So that reputation is great to have. And but yeah, you're right. It does come with some pressure. If you think about the October event and how things have sold out before the tickets being put on, before a match has even been announced, then that comes with pressure, because you don't want to then be going, right, here's what we've got in October, and people are kind of going, oh, maybe I shouldn't have. But I know they will once we've announced the card, because it's got the kind of disco backbone. You know, it's got the things that I know people love about our events. They're all kind of sprinkled throughout the show, but it does come with an added bit of pressure, you know, when you've had so many kind of well-known international talents as part of your events in the past. You know, instantly when you announce we've got the anniversary events happening in this state, people will expect to see something massive, because we've delivered massive in the past. So I guess this is maybe, again, me and my period of kind of expectation management, but that's just because of the kind of situations we're in just now. It's not through the lack of not wanting to. It's just a kind of, right, let's just go with what is actually doable right now and what can absolutely be done right now with the kind of conditions that we're in. But once things are properly kind of opened and we know for sure that, for example, we can bring X, Y, or Z in without restrictions or without worry of restrictions, then it'll happen again. But it's, you know, we're just in that period of just hoping people stay with us and people stick with us. And you know, the what we're presenting come October, you know, there's going to be a lot of fresh faces. There's going to be a lot of new faces. There's going to be a lot of new characters. There's going to be a lot of fun. There's going to be a lot of great wrestling. So there will be people on the card that fans will perhaps not be overly familiar with, but once they come to that first event and once they see these people in action, they're going to see what we see, and I think they'll enjoy it.
You've perfectly, it's like you read my mind, you perfectly segued what I was going to do into next, which is young talent. Of course, the last 18 months, there's been very little I mean, there's been some, of course, some wrestling on WWE Network that we know. So it's a case of you've been able to step back in that time, obviously, try and dip your toe back in with it, making these announcements and then them going horribly wrong. But you're able to step back and go, right, you'll be able to look at this guy, see how they're performing, see how what they're doing for the training. Names that come to mind, like Jason Reed, of course, who looks to be getting into phenomenal shape. Andy Wilde, Caleb Valhalla. So you've been able to kind of, have you been like the watcher, just watching over all these wrestlers doing their training, get what they're putting out there to see, well, maybe they could be, we can get them into disco at some time.
Yeah, I mean, there are people who I've been wanting to work with for a while, that it just never happened before lockdown hit. There are people who have perhaps made one or two, you know, appearances with us in the past that we never got on a good run with them because, you know, with other shows clashing or what, for whatever reason. So it has given us a chance to kind of sit back and look at, right, okay, what are we going to do when we come back? And let's start building. It's almost it kind of feels like starting afresh, you know, when you're going, right, okay, this person can work with this person, then maybe this person can develop in this way, or maybe we can see how this goes, you know, a feud going this way, or, you know, it feels like we've kind of gone back to the drawing board a bit. You know, obviously we've kept a bit of a disco backbone, as I mentioned, about having, you know, you'll see your Joe Henrys and your Andy Wilds and Emerson Janes, you know, people who've been with disco since show one, event one, are still here. But we've kind of looked again just at, you know, other wrestlers that we want to give an opportunity to see how that might work in disco. So there will be a few people, a few wrestlers that might be unfamiliar to our audience when we come back. And we also have been working with, you know, a couple of the schools. You know, we were very closely aligned to Reckless Intent in Livingston. You know, I had a good run there as their most celebrated hardcore champion of all time. I think it was their most successful hardcore champion of all time. So, you know, we've got a good relationship with them, and they've got their training school, and they've got a lot of exciting talent coming through there. Working with Joe Hendry in his training school as well, and he's got a lot of exciting talent coming out of his school as well. It potentially could be on a disco event one day soon. We know of Andy Wilde and his school in Fife as well, so there's great talent coming out of his school, which you'll have seen in ICW and on the network as well, you know, so he's got a lot of his talent going good places. So there's a lot of exciting new talent coming through. There's a lot of exciting talent who's still on the scene. We're not going to be, you know, we're not going to be short of a good wrestler. And you know, I'm just mentioning a couple of places I've been working closely with, but then of course there's the guys in the Northeast, you know, WrestleZone as well. They've got a lot of good talent there that perhaps don't get the attention down in the kind of central areas. Because, you know, they're very much focused up in the Northeast. So, you know, we'll be looking at wrestlers from all over the country. I want to give opportunities to as many as we can. Perhaps give opportunities to a lot of wrestlers who don't normally get the spotlight elsewhere. So that's kind of what the method was when we first launched, was looking at wrestlers who we know are good, who know they've got good character, who could excite the crowd, that perhaps weren't in the top spots elsewhere and perhaps weren't getting all the attention elsewhere, that we thought, right, maybe we could do something, and maybe they could be seen as a, you know, disco kind of regular. So that's, again, that we've kind of taken that approach again for the October show. It's just to start looking at, right, okay, let's see who we can bring in and let's see if this works.
So it wouldn't be an interview that I do without some sort of mention of WrestleZone. So let's tick that box off for a minute. but yeah, it is that melting pot. And like you're saying, I mean, way back when we started, of course, you had Damien and you had, you would have had Stallion at the time. You had Ian Ambrose. And these are guys that they may not have been outside of their territory before. Yeah. And to see them all in this kind of one one show is kind of exciting, and you do have other companies that are trying to do the same thing, of course, in Perth and what have you. So it's one of those times that you're hoping it's going to be in the next big boom, because everyone's just going to be just wanting to see some wrestling. I know I am. I don't know when it's going to be, because the first show that's coming up near me, unfortunately, I'm ironically in Edinburgh at the time, so I can't see it. So it's, I'm just like, just on tenterhooks, just want, I want to see some wrestling. So we'll wrap up then with one final push. There's not that many tickets, or no tickets left.
There's no tickets.
It's gone.
We don't need to plug that. We do have the anniversary event is scheduled for the end of November, on November 28th. And again, that's going to be in the Baron at the Corn Exchange. So we'll put tickets for that on sale at the end of this month. So at the end of September, tickets will go on sale for that event. And we might just take the same approach and just announce the event and see how it goes without announcing a single match. And we are working on things for the anniversary event that will have a big feel about it. How things are coming together for that event. Obviously, a lot depends on how October goes. You know, we'll kick off our tag team tournament in October. We've got our two title matches in October. There'll be a lot of new faces in October and some new heels as well. So you'll see a lot of kind of hopefully things will just feel like disco. That's all I want. It's not about let's have a totally fresh feel, let's have a new direction or whatever. I just want the disco feeling, and that's what we're trying to keep when we come back. So hopefully fans get a kick out of us coming back and stick with us, and then we'll rock into the new year. We'll have a disco derby next year. We'll do our Back to the Future gimmick next year. We might see some international friends coming back over at some point next year. You know, there's a lot to look forward to. We're also going to be streaming at events as well. That's something kind of new as well, that we're going to be doing some tapings. So we did it originally with one platform, but it was a very kind of crowded platform. And then things started to go on YouTube, and then we started to do some highlight shows for Fight, and then individual matches have been on YouTube. So we've not really put on full events, haven't been getting streamed online. It's always just been, here's a great match, here's a fun match, here's people battling zombies. You know, it's been these kind of individual kind of matchups have gone online. So when we do come back, because obviously there are a lot of people who didn't manage to get tickets for our comeback event, so what we're going to be doing is events will be getting taped and going up as a hopefully seemingly polished kind of production of a wrestling show will be going up online. So that's something to look forward to as well. That's something new that we're going to be doing. We've got a decent platform to be streaming this, and that's going to be something we're looking to do going forward. So it'll be a couple of tapings, and then who knows, if we get comfortable and if I can get clued up on my tech stuff, then we might start live streaming as well. So there's all these kind of exciting things to kind of do. And, you know, how can we take disco to the next level? These are the things that we're going to start exploring.
Wonderful. Right. So we're not plugging tickets for the next show. No. For the show that's coming up, because we don't need to. Anyone, if you want to buy a t-shirt, where can people go? Where can people buy to go to check out Discovery Wrestling and of course buy your wonderful merch?
DiscoWrestling.com is the place. We have new t-shirts that were just launched in the last couple of months, the last month or so. You could choose, you get a pink one or you could get a yellow one. We give people options. So we've got new t-shirts on our website, DiscoWrestling.com. On Twitter, we're DiscoWrestling at DiscoWrestling. So that was fairly easy. Facebook, /DiscoveryWrestling. That was also fairly easy. Instagram is the one that always trips me up, because I leave it up to our broadcast analyst, Darren T. Goss.
International broadcast analyst.
Yes. He helps a lot with a lot of our kind of social media stuff. So he always kicks me when I get these things wrong. So I'm pretty sure Instagram is Discovery_Wrestling. I'm hoping I get that right, and I've not sent someone to some completely weird Instagram page. I think it is Discovery_Wrestling. So you could get us on all those kind of social media accounts, give us a follow, head over to Discovery Wrestling on YouTube. You'll see loads of great matches from the last 6 years of disco wrestling. Yeah, loads of fantastic matches. And just click subscribe on the YouTubes.
Perfect. Well, thank you for taking the time out your day to just plug Discovery Wrestling, which I know is not a difficult job, but no. I wish you all the best of luck, and I can't wait.
Cheers.
I'll be the one that will be signing up to the streaming as soon as possible, I'm sure.
Awesome. And if you're in Edinburgh at a time of an event, you've got to come and check it out and see it firsthand. Because I don't think there's anything that beats the kind of live experience in person, and just being part of that disco crowd when things get a little bit nuts. There's nothing else like it.
I know it's the best thing, because I know that seems like a natural end of the podcast, and as always I'll screw up at the end, but it's always the case when we're going down to Glasgow or Edinburgh. I don't know if I'm doing very good at home or something, because I'm living at home and I do all the housework now, but my wife does go, is there any wrestling on the day that we're not doing the other thing? I'm like, drat, just never is. So next time I'm going out to Edinburgh, I'll let you know, and we'll set a schedule for the day that I'm not doing the actual thing we're supposed to be going down for.
You can make your disco debut.
Exactly. Oh, I honestly can't wait. But yeah, thanks again for taking time, chat.
No, thank you.